Today we are diving into the GMKTec NucBox M5 powered by the AMD Ryzen 7 5700U processor. I picked up this barebones model in a sale for just £155. I think it was down from £260. So I've customized it with two 32GB RAM sticks and dual NVMe drives, one dedicated to my Proxmox for running VMs, and the other ones for backups or restores. The compact design and efficiency mean it's set to handle my virtual environments while helping cut down on my electricity bills. Let's see how it performs. Just delivered the GMKTec mini PC in a smooth silver package that's as sleek as the device inside. Carefully wrapped and marked fragile, it's ready to be unboxed and explored. And to unwrap that, I have a special guest. Meet Mr. Umair.
So we're supposed to open this with this dangerous wicked knife.
First, we're gonna see the box. That's the box.
Is this broken? Is this chair broken?
And that is a barebone model.
Okay. Have you opened
China?
It? No! Oh! From China? Yeah. I just had to let it out. They're falling.
That's how it looks in the box.
Oh, that is like.
That's the front cover. AMD Ryzen 7 5000 series with AMD Radeon graphics. GMKTec logo. Front, you have power. And then you have USB Type-C Gen 2, and then two USB 3.2 Gen 2s as well at the front. And on the side, here are your cooling vents. Hopefully that will keep it cool. And at the back, you have all the other ports. So you have your DC power connector. Then you have two 2.5 gigabits per second LAN ports. These are good for PFSense. Then you have HDMI and display ports, and then two USB 2.0 ports. And finally, that is your Kensington lock if you want to lock the device down. And finally, at the bottom, you have more ventilation. And then on the other side, you have more cooling vents with a very good mesh design. And at the bottom, you have your ventilation holes for more ventilation. And it is GMK NucBox M5 model. And very good design. I'm very pleased with it. So let's look at what's in the box. So I put on the side is the box. You have manual, that's in English. I don't know if it's Chinese or Japanese. And okay, so mounting brackets, HDMI lead, the screwdriver is nice as well, and the power cord. And this should be the power GMP sticker. And that's the power adapter, 19 volt power adapter. So what we are going to do is we are, because this is a bare bone model, we are going to install two sticks of 32 gigs of RAM and a Samsung NVMe. It off is very easy. So you just take the front cover off. And just take these screws off, four screws. Once screws are off, there's a fan here. You just carefully pull this off. And take this off. You need to be careful because the fan is connected to the motherboard, so you can disconnect from the motherboard. Okay, so that is disconnected and we put it there, and let's have a look inside. So we have two NVMe slots and we have two soldering slots for your RAM. Actually, I was expecting only one NVMe slot, so an additional one is a pleasant surprise. So there is a screw here which we'll be using to mount the NVMe on the motherboard. In fact, let's install RAM first. So I've got Crucial 32 gigs sodium 3200 megahertz RAM available, so let's install that. And to be installed, just unplug these from here. To insert RAM, just put that in there and press down. Let's get the other one in. Here is the other one I had laying around, same speed, just a different brand, Transcend. So just align that and push down and secured. Let's do the RAM NVMe now. For that, we need a smaller screwdriver. Okay, so take it off. There's the Samsung 970 Evo I have laying around. It's 1 terabyte. Let's install this. Just align this. Press it down and get the screw back in. Okay, so just screwing in the NVMe to secure it, and thus it's installed. It comes with a module. Wi-Fi module, there it is, and I'll install another NVMe. I'm gonna put Proxmox on and I will do some power consumption readings as well. So let's do that. So here is the power consumption. So as you can see, it's sitting at about 13 to 14 watts, goes up to 18 watts, and then quickly drops down to between 10, 12, 13 watts. So it's very power efficient as compared to my Dell R720, which is a powerhouse. So the mission is accomplished, reduce power bills. And to show you that I've already installed Proxmox on it, and this is the workload that is currently running on it. Summary, you can see it identified all my CPUs, 16 threads, 5700U Radeon graphics. I'm not using GPU at the moment because I probably just don't need it for now. I've installed 64 gigs of RAM, which is about like 60 gigs is recognized. IO delay is really good, as you can see, nearly 0.0%. So if your VMs are slow, probably it's due to IO delay as well. So please use good NVMe's. And I'm pretty pleased with the performance it has. I'm running pfSense in dual configuration or high availability configuration. So if you want to see a video how I did that, please let me know. That's my Pi-hole server. I've also set up AWX server, which takes care of all my Ansible related playbooks. DMZ services are the services I'm publicly hosting, like my website, blog, etc. I use Ventoy for network boot, and this Oasis is for my media, using it for traffic reverse proxy and media servers and WireGuard, stuff like that. So I'm very happy with the results. Power consumption is usually under 20 watts, which is nothing as compared to, you know, I used to get about 150 watts for my Dell R720. So that Dell R720 is now my running my AI workload. And let me know if you want to see how I set up my AI stack. So that is now on demand, which is brilliant. And yeah, that's a quick overview of how I'm running my Proxmox and HomeLab these days in a very power efficient way. Thank you for watching.